the Star Ladder I League Chinese 13 playoff match, actually. It's going to be the lower bracket for now. We're going to have one upper bracket match a little bit later, but we are looking at the last two tickets to the Minsk LAN going to be claimed today. So kicking things off, we're going to be having Wings versus DK Scuderia, and then we'll be checking out Newbie Young versus FTDB. The winner of that will face off the winner of this, and one of those teams will be going to the next stage. So that's going to be really exciting. Actually, it looks like LGD already claimed their souls. Yeah, that was 2 days back. Okay. Well, we're all sorted out. We know exactly what's going on. And let's jump into that draft. Sorry, it's 2 o'clock in the morning for me. That is a little disorienting, but I'm up, I'm ready to roll, and I'm excited for these matches here. So, starting things off, we've got ourselves the DK lineup looking pretty interesting here with a Visage third pick. They opened up with the Bane Slaughter, which I feel is really good for your lane configuration. Obviously, Nightmare Crush or just having the beefy Bane bully back is those that would otherwise best him. I think that that's just going to allow you to stabilize really well and get that Blink deck at a pretty good time. Bane is a hero that we've seen more and more in the Chinese scene, dual laning in the mid lane, putting out pressure there, bullying back the opposition. And yeah, it makes it very difficult to go for like glass cannon farmers and not feel like you're at a disadvantage. But a few of those have been banned out already. We'll see what mids actually do hit the pool, and if Bane prioritizes putting out pressure on the mid lane or in fact the off lane. Tusk Undying, obviously a great opener though from the Wings Gaming, to enable them to get a lot of pressure on the enemy safe lane carry, and with no Dazzle to protect him, it's actually going to be very difficult. Witch Doctor, I think, is probably one of the better heroes to support now against the Tusk Undying. The Voodoo Restoration and Cask are both very powerful against the Tusk Undying duo, but it's not going to be easy no matter what you look at, and maybe they just go with the Visage there. Maybe they just say, okay, we are going to be under a lot of fire, but as long as we can fire some shots back, then that's going to be okay. So they voluntarily acquire the Visage for potentially their safe lane. We'll see. Lina is going to be the third pick here for the Wings Gaming, and fourth pick here is going to be Tiny for DK Scuderia. So I expect they won't even bother with Wispan, just because it's clearly going to be an a la carte Tiny. He's just not going to be paired up, he's going to be doing his own thing on the mid lane. A very tanky hero, he's got a thick hide, and that's going to be really strong against effects like Decay and obviously Laguna Blade. Really heavy burst damage that looks to just single you out and kill you off. Not going to be much of a factor when you have so much raw HP to work with. Though right now Mechanism isn't going to be online for a long time for the Visage, so not confident in that regard just yet. We're going to see the Wraith King picked up here for the Wings Gaming, a good safe laner to not die off easily to the Slardar. He could definitely go blow for blow with him if he emphasizes either some RNG crit, maybe some lifesteal, or maybe just good lane sustain. But yeah, I'm still not entirely confident in terms of the Wraith King versus the Tiny. Obviously, he's got high HP, so the Tiny can't just kill him off with an Avalanche Toss when he gets a Blink Dagger. He's got Reincarnate, so that minimizes the effectiveness, especially once Wraith King is level 11. At the same time, as we go towards the later stages of the game where Tiny is kind of a semi-carry, Wraith King won't easily be able to hit that craggy exterior unless he's got a BKB up, so a little problematic, but as long as our Wraith King goes for a BKB this game, it should be okay. And there's, of course, lots of ways to control him, not just Craggy. Now, the final bans here, they're actually going to ban up the Slark, so obviously still looking for a safe laner that they cannot really jump on easily. Templar Assassin banned out for the Wings, making them me think that Lina support is a possibility here. I mean, they run safe lane Wraith King, they run the offlane Tusk, then you've got the Lean on the Undying as supports, and that would obviously lend an opening for the mid lane. DK Scuderia going to pick up the Vengeful Spirit. I believe they were the team to pick this up yesterday. Kind of caught me off guard, a little surprising, but we've got to see a lot of positioning control mechanics come into play in that game, and maybe the swap is just one to really reset the tone of the engagement. It's obviously really good against Snowball. If you see exactly who's being snowballed on, you swap them back as far as possible, and that snowball is not only going to break without doing anything, but put your opponent behind enemy lines. So, could be very powerful. We'll have to see.
10 seconds remaining.
I could also see somebody just being swapped right next to the Tiny and being killed off like instantly with Avalanche Toss and, if necessary, a Soul Assumption.
Viper.
But Viper is a tanky hero. So I would have to say that it's not going to be the easiest exchange no matter what. Overall, the Wings Gaming, they really have beefed up. I mean, you look at all their heroes other than Lina, and they're able to really take as much as they dish out. They are durable heroes, by definition. So I would have to say that DK, with their kind of instant quick kill lineup, are going to have a little bit of difficulty finding traction in the early skirmishes, but in terms of scalability, they've got more going on in the mid to late game. So the Wings Gaming, they're going to look to gain a point of leverage here in the early stages of the game. Probably within 35 minutes, they want to take a significant advantage, either full map dominance or maybe a lane of racks. And the Wings don't really have turtle, honestly. Like, they have no way to hold their high ground, especially if it's like a 5v4 approach, which is most common when one team is dominating the map. So, I gotta say, as much as I like heroes like Visage and Vengeful Spirit, I feel like they aren't gonna fit into this draft as cleanly as maybe DK Scuderi were hoping, and I feel like they might find some difficulty here. Do have a few guys that went to the bathroom. It looks like Wrong has been drafting up by himself with one fellow partner in crime helping out in terms of the overall strategy going into the game. But yeah, we do have ourselves best of three series here. This is just going to be game one. I myself am Blaze. I don't even think I got to introduce myself and just trying to get my head sorted this morning. But I am going to be joined by a co-caster in the subsequent games here. We've got three best of threes, obviously potentially nine games, and I don't want to go all that alone. I'm going to be bringing in Hades for the next one. Unfortunately, he didn't get into lobby for the first game, which is, you know, fine. We'll have him for the rest of the day, so no big deal. Alright, so, yeah, Tusk is going to be kind of supporting here. It's going to be Beyond to mostly get the farm down bottom. And Innocence, I think, plays a 5 position here. So Alina, with no items, might have some difficulty against Slaughter, but as long as she has somebody like the Wraith King nearby, it should really suppress the aggression of XXS until he has a Blink Dagger. I guess Tranquil Boots would still be a defining aspect of his lane. Once he gets Tranquils and he's full HP, he's probably not too scared of just Lina and Wraith King. As far as the safe lane pickup there, they went with the Venge as, I believe, the support, right? Yeah, because they've already had the Visage and the Bane. Well, no, in that case, yeah, Visage, Bane, and Venge. One of those guys is going to be taking core farm. I mostly like Visage in that capacity, but I don't know if that's what the route they want to go. Obviously, Vengeful Spirit core is a thing. She has an agility gain of 3.3. She's already got herself a basic enhancement that she gives to everybody, as well as a negative armor effect. The reason why she's such a good support is because these aren't selfish buffs and debuffs. They are something that she gives to everybody on her team. So she doesn't have to be the one dishing out the damage, but it also doesn't hurt. If she picks up an early Solar Crest or Desolator, she can put out a lot of damage. If she gets like a Blink Dagger or a Force Staff, of course, she can be very mobile with her swap. So that can definitely be a game changer. If you have an early Blink Dagger and a Vengeful Spirit, and you swap an opponent from a safe position to a more dangerous one next to your allies, and then immediately blink back before you take any damage, then you just got a free pick off. You're like a Batrider. It actually has a lot of value to it. But of course, also some limitations. She is a 400 attack range hero, 300 base movement speed, and yeah, just doesn't have any scaling beyond what she would normally give as a support. Obviously, she gets these skills maxed out faster, the Wave of Terror and the Vengeance Aura, but, you know. Alright, somebody in chat said my voice on game is a bit errored. Can you expand on that? I don't fully understand. I'm going to go ahead and reset just to satisfy that basic aspect. But I have no idea what error you're referencing there. Alrighty, so, of course, Shadow's going to be taking the safe lane Wraith King. Could be looking for just the Midas Blink buildup that we saw yesterday. Obviously, there are alternatives like Radiance and Blade Mail that are pretty strong on the hero. Ice, I guess Beyond could pick up the mechanism. There's like three different heroes that could pick up the mechanism. I would say the Undying's going to be too underfarmed to get it at a good time, so you'd much more likely want it on the Viper or the Tusk. And we'll see who they decide in that capacity. Midases are going to be an interesting question for the Dire side. Does the Wraith King want one? Does the Viper want one? I don't think the Tusk will. He's really more momentum-based, so you don't want to put yourself 2,000 gold in the hole voluntarily. And also, honestly, Walrus Punch level 3 is kind of terrible. Like, it's barely different than level 1. It's a very minor buff. So yeah, I wouldn't say the Tusk is really worrying about his scaling. He really wants his items as soon as possible. So then that would leave really the Viper and the Wraith King with the potential Hand of Midas pickups. Still waiting. Boubacar ran a great Bane last game, so I expect him to be the one to pick up the Bane. But other than that, should be pretty interesting. Long pause to start us off for the day. It doesn't help my sore throat any, but we'll get through it. So, Visage or Venge obviously are going to be the cores. In either case, you're going to be seeing some negative armor effects against Wings, so they're going to try to mitigate that. Obviously, the early mechanism is one way to do it. Basilius or Ring of Aquila is another good aura effect to enhance armor to deal with the Wave of Terror and the most likely Medallion. One of these guys is going to pick up a Medallion for sure. So that means beyond that, you're maybe looking at getting a Bassi upgraded to a Vladimir's Offering. And at that point, I think Wings really want to sustain the engagement. When you've got yourself a Vampiric Aura for 30%, and then of course you can buy up the Vladimir's Offering for another 10-15%, I believe. Yeah, 10-15% lifesteal, and of course the armor. You're really looking for the sustained engagement. You're looking to kind of stretch it out. So getting multiple Lightstrike Arrays is going to be much more important for the lean in the fights than just getting the perfect ultimate. And then things like just getting the right heals out with the Soul Rip. I could even consider like an Aghanim Scepter a real pickup this game for Wraith King. Like sometimes it's just a, hey, I have a free item slot, it's 45 minutes, let's grab an Axe and help out the team. But I actually think this could be like a third item Aghanim Scepter. Like you go Midas, Blink, Axe. I could see that just because of how valuable these heroes are when they sustain and when they continue to put up pressure. I mean, you can see an Undying get like 7 free seconds of life to get off 2 more decays. You can get the, obviously, more Lightstrike Arrays, like I said, from the Lina. The Viper, putting out more and more toxin. I actually think there's a lot of strength in the Aghanims this game. Alrighty, looks like we're good to go, guys. Long time waiting, but we are here into game one of this best of three series, and let's see how it pans out. Boubacar going for the Null Talisman start, but he's still going to be playing that four possession support. He just starts Null Talisman to really trade heavily in mid, and he still ends up helping out the team for the most part. The Visage is actually going to be picking up some wards for himself, so Wrong is also going to be playing support, and that means you've got yourself a core Venge. Vengeful Spirit. Lovely lady here is going to be, oh, and a tower high, is going to be taking this one position, and this will be, make things very interesting. They're going to dodge out this smoke here. Obviously, the snowball smoke in the Radiant Jungle is one of the more scary to deal with, because they could be coming up either path, and either way, if you're trying to scout it out and break the smoke, you're already in snowball range. So they just completely dodge it out, stay away from their jungle, and say, you can have our pull camps, you can ward them up how you wish. So there's obviously a lot of possibilities for the wards here, but other than that, to battle, they're not going to lose too much here because they're not too dependent on the camps being pulled and the camps being stacked, etc. This is an interesting observer ward, though. The Dire get at least a nice bit of leverage here, but it looks like it's been pinged out. I really like that, but no, they couldn't have seen that. They definitely just think there are heroes here. They cannot have seen this ward. Oh, actually, Shadow might get caught out here. It's going to be multiple stuns going his way. It will be the Grave Chill to slow him down, and the first blood will be spilled for the Visage. So Wrong going to be starting off very strong here. As far as early bounty runes, you've got one on the Viper, one on the Tiny. And obviously, it's a pretty tough matchup for the Tiny. He's going to have to stay back. If the Viper plays it well, he's going to be kited and zoned very effectively just with the long-range harassment of the Viper with a poison attack. And the decay doesn't help either. I talked about his high HP pool making decay kind of irrelevant. But that's a lot later in the game with his 3.0 strength gain coming into play. For now, it's 600 HP, which still is a big factor. Anyways, down bottom, there's going to be some damage coming in to Slardar here. Two stuns going out against him will kind of send him packing, but he does have a lot of Tangos and the Mango regen to work with. Venge is going to be farming up top here, interestingly enough, with the Visage. These two are going to be going up 2v1 against Beyond's Tusk. So I overall think that they're going to be pretty happy in how much last hit progression the Vengeful Spirit's going to get. Early CS lead is going to be going to the Viper and the Wraith King, but I would say that there's still more kill potential on the Radiant side early on, especially when that Soul Assumption comes out shortly for the Visage. Of course, there are abilities like Snowball to dodge that kind of spell out, but the mid lane is probably going to be the matchup that's most interesting, because obviously bottom is being dominated, Slaughter just has to stay back and hope for Tranquil Boots. But mid lane, we got double decay on Tiny, who's taking some poison attacks, and yeah, he's gonna have to eat some Tangos to offset it. Beyond, still pretty heavily suppressed, just wants to get a snowball, because otherwise he has no way to deal with the projectiles that the Venge and Visage throw his way. But we're gonna see a bit of a rune engagement here. The Nightmare will come out on the Undying, Bounty Rune grabbed by Bobokop, and he's just gonna play Grand Theft Rune. No problem. I'm now moving himself up. Stronger than before with the Golden Experience takeaway. Y-Chan, unfortunately, not getting the last hit here. 70 damage thanks to the decay. Means that it's just going to be harder and harder for him to find those creep kills. And now he's actually dropping really low. If that decay hit, oh my gosh, he would absolutely be dead. That Soul Rip dropped him down to 26 HP. And Innocence might still have this one. Y-Chan bottling behind and between the towers. Looks like he'll bottle crawl immediately thereafter, but he'll be at half HP, so Innocence shouldn't just kill him off outright. But as I say that, double damage coming out, putting some decent hits into Bobokop before Innocence has to back off. So this frees up the bottom lane a little bit. XXS, you see him much more aggressive here onto Shadow, getting much more involved, gonna be crushing while he has the mana to do so, and just forcing the Wraith King back. He does have Ring of Protection Stout Shield, so he's not really worried about the creep wave too much, but it just simply is, while the Lina is away, Slaughter gets to play. A lot of pulling has been going on here. They didn't block it, or at least, it looks like they tried to block it, but it's just out of range. It's actually just outside the box there. That little flower is deceiving. It looks like a landmark, but it's not actually going to be. And there's going to be the jump down bottom. Not only was Innocence roaming in from this position, but the Undying actually made a TP play down bottom after he had refilled at the well. So, they go ahead, they set it up, Shadow starts off with the Wraith Fire Blast, and it's pretty much a clean kill from there. But yeah, I think they did mean to block that off. We're gonna see, however, it gets stacked up, it get double pulled. Beyond's gotten a lot of pulls off here, and they haven't really done anything about it. I'm kinda worried about this costing DK Scuderia a lot of experience. I mean, they're really not getting that much done in the offlane if they're not suppressing Tusk the same way that Slaughter is being inhibited. Viper gonna give himself that Ring of Aquila pretty soon. For now, just the Magic Wand and Bassy. XXS actually has to watch himself here. If there was a little bit more mana on the Wraith King, he'd be in some trouble, but I guess he does realize that he is lacking keeping tabs on what spells they have in their arsenal. Beyond actually makes a nice little move here, cutting through a tree, and finds himself in a pretty safe spot, but why would you do that? They can follow you here, and you don't have a way to cut through. He no longer has Tangos, he no longer has Ice Shards. That's actually a very dangerous play to make, but obviously they're just looking for the tower right now. Wave of Terror? You could Wave of Terror the tree line right here. Okay. Weird exchange, honestly. You don't see something like that very often, so yeah, they're quite perplexed as far as where he ran off to. And I don't think that's in the detection range of the tower. We'll see XXS under tower, getting hit by the tombstones as well as Light Strike Ray. Wrong actually going to be dropping very low quickly. He doesn't have a passive. He doesn't have his Gravekeeper's Cloak. So the zombie slow, a few more right clicks, he's going to be dropping very low, but he will survive. Can't say the same about the Tusk. He tries to make his way away and does get caught out here. Nightmare setting up Magic Missile combo. And you're going to see Wave of Terror maxed out on Venge. Obviously, that means the low-scaling magic Radiant's missile is going to be only attack. Stunning out for a second and a half, but at the same time, you really want to emphasize just physical damage output on the Venge here. So she's going to go the phase boots, and then, like I said, probably solar crest. XXS caught out here in the ice shard, snowball, and if they get one more stun, that is going to be a kill. Lightstrike Ray does not hit, though. Viper making his way towards Mechanism in pretty good pace. And covering up the runes, why Chen just finds himself a bounty. So if you just look at overall CS for the Tiny, that's the biggest thing this game, in my opinion. I mean, obviously there was the tier 1 kill up top, the kill score is 2-2, but those are kind of minor factors that just kind of trade evenly. Shadow almost gets caught, but not. But anyways, you compare that to the CS in the mid, and that's the big difference maker here. While the side lanes have been relatively even in what they've accomplished this game, the mid lane's completely different in terms of its overall back and forth. Obviously, Beyond in some trouble here. Soul Assumption should do enough. He would have to mango snowball, and probably even then he would die. It would just delay it. So, Bubblegum caught out a little bit here. Wraith Fire Blast, again, unavailable though. He's really lacking in the mana department, this Shadow. A Magic Wand would probably do him some good, but he wants to finish the treads off and go for the Intelligence Swap whenever he gets the chance. Ice Eye's going to take some hits here, maybe gets the Soul Rip out. Oh, goes for the Double Decay instead. That's going to put a lot of damage into QD. Their Core Venge has fallen. Now Bobaka's isolated as well. Courier, run, Drodo, run! And that is going to be the death of the Bane. Well, the Drodo does make it away with half HP. So yeah, CS on the Tiny, 17-4. CS on the Viper, 42-16. Doing really good this game, just keeping control, and actually catching the Ice Shards with the Viper Strike! What synergy! They've actually just timed that perfectly. It will be a Toss Avalanche, kind of poking them back, and they don't want to go under Tower for this one, but man, they're still just making things happen and overall gaining momentum in this game. Winx, they're going to have a really strong mid game. The question is if they can win the game sufficiently enough that they are not afraid of the late game. Alrighty, so I assume Blink Dagger for the Slaughter of the Tiny, negative armor and attack damage. Oh, it looks like a Yasha for the Vengeful Spirit. Interesting. She has her phase. She's going for Yasha. It's a lot of movement speed, which kind of makes up for what I said before, the 400 attack range, 300 MS.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
And Beyond could be in some trouble if he gets hit by a couple of spells here. He might get a little overconfident, and Ron could come in with a level 3 Soul Assumption. Pretty powerful. Meantime, though, Shadow just goes for an interesting build here. 3-1-2, and is able to lifesteal jungle for the most part. And despite this Observer Ward knowing it, Innocence has made his way back to bottom, and is going to try for another play that, in this case, seems not to be too successful. What they could actually do is keep Wrong in the trees. Oh, well, or put him out forward. Yeah, if they keep Wrong in the trees, they put Slaughter up here, and they go for the tower dive. So Vissis puts out two Assault Assumptions, gets not only an even kill exchange, but with one TP, can actually make it a 2-for-1. But XSS has had such a tough laning phase and is progressing towards that Blink Dagger so slowly that they might not even be willing to sacrifice it for the better of the team. Buckler up for Viper. Once that mech is finished, I think the death ball begins. Around that time, Shadow's going to be getting his own blink, most likely. Not going Midas, as you can see, he picked up all those other items. He's actually TPing bottom. We'll see if the Radiant sees this. The vision they get from that Observer is not very helpful. So if he jukes in the trees, if he goes in the tree line, then they're going to see it, and they do. So they know Shadow's here, but it's still going to be the snowball play coming under tower. We'll see if Ron can get any return kills here with that Soul Assumption. Ice Ice takes a big hit. Y-Chen will finish it off, but now Shadow's here, and is going to be going right onto the Tiny himself. Nice Nightmare onto Shadow. You want to ignore the Wraith King as long as possible in this fight, and it's actually going to be allowing them to do a lot of damage with the Soul Assumption. With one more Grave Chill slow, they're going to make it a 3-4-3. Shadow under tower taking a lot of hits here, but they're going to kill him off before the next Wraithfire Blast. Reincarnate will pop, but now they can just Nightmare and try to run. No, they have to fight it now. Ron pops the Familiars, doing so much damage. One stun, two stun, but will they be able to finish it off? No, they don't have the final Onslaught of Burst to finish off Shadow. They're just going to have to crush the Viper and split their focus. They now have two really low HP heroes instead of one. They will be able to finish off the Viper, but at the cost of the Venge, who again is a carry here. Has a Laguna Blade up on the Innocence, but oh my gosh, that amp damage with the birds. You gotta be afraid. Bobokaw's going forward. This is not the fight you want to keep going with. They're obviously reinforcing this position, and one zombie, no! Almost is enough to kill him off there, but Solrip was on CD. And one familiar just died. It looks like a second one might join him. Yep, that's enough of hits, and they'll get both birds immediately after the summon. They've only been in play for 50 seconds. Now they're both dead, and the tower with them. So that is actually, on the tail end, favorable for Wings. If DK Scare were able to find a way to disengage after they found their first three kills, or maybe the reincarnate, then I would say that they can walk away happily, even losing the tower. But they kept on fighting, and I feel like Wings' respawns were just the stronger factor of contention. Especially since you have to remember how the TP delay affects your ability to reinforce this kind of position. You already TP two heroes at least down to that spot to fight on the bottom lane. So anybody that respawns is going to get at least a 4-second TP, if not a 5-second TP. And that's going to actually cost you in terms of your ability to reinforce and the ability for Wings to prepare for whoever is joining the fray. We're actually going to see a flank position here. Bobokaw will just go for the Fiend's Grip, and that should be enough to kill off Shadow here. A couple of hits, and down he goes. Tusk tries to get involved, but now he'll be having some sweet dreams. Bobokaw probably going to be killed off here. A great flank for the Lina. Oh no, the Ice Shards push him away. And that means Bobokaw will live to see another day. Tiny almost to the blink. Slaughter should be... Oh no, he actually lost a lot in that previous kill exchange. 0-3 now. And they do end up picking up somebody, but it's going to be the Lily Venge, who... I want to keep on emphasizing that she is has been given one position priority, but every time she goes down, it just doesn't feel like it. She's so frail. She's so squishy. And that's probably why you don't see her in a carry sense very often. I mean, yeah, she's a core that comes online very early, but she's also one that can't really hold her gold. And if you have any advantage, the comeback gold mechanic is going to be taking it right back the other way. Actually, Tiny just used both his spells, so there's no hope for him here. He's gonna be able to maybe go for a toss with the Soul Assumption, take Ice low. Nice Nightmare attempt, but it's not enough to save the Mounted Giant. Now Beyond, no mana left, should be in some trouble. Yeah, Slaughter's got the perfect flank, but he's actually going onto the other two here. He goes and hits on Viper and Lina, and the new familiars come out! There's gonna be a Snowball, there's gonna be a Swap, making things a little bit more complicated here. XXX goes down to the Viper Strike and the Shards, and we're actually going to see QD in some real trouble again. Look how fast he dies! What worth of Avenge do you have if you can't actually keep him alive? Like, he has gone for this Glass Cannon build, Band of Elven Skin Phase Boots, and yet he dies just as quickly as a support Venge would. He's actually accomplishing almost nothing more than a support Venge. And this farm seems to have been wasted.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Like, he's up here, 4,600 net worth. It's top of his team's net worth, but you wouldn't realize it. And that's unfortunate. I would... yeah, he's gonna go for the Yasha still, but... It's a definite concern right now. Blade Mill for the Wraith King. Obviously, stronger in the fact that he has two lives to bring to the fight. Means the Blade Mill can possibly be used twice, and he just has a larger health pool to work with. It's not easy to focus this guy down, and essentially, yeah, he challenges you to a duel, where you just... he's life-stealing off of you, he's potentially critting you, and you're just taking as much damage as he receives. Great Observer Ward placement here from the Lina is actually going to set them up for an early Roshan. You usually expect the Slaughter Venge team to go for the Rosh really early. That's a huge aspect of their momentum. But instead, we're going to see a familiar picked off, and while this is very clearly being done by Wings, DK Skadera can't really get in the pit easy. Shadow here with his Blade Mail and his Reincarnate is obviously going to be in the front line in this fight. DK Skadera looked to force the engagement, but Rosh is already half dead. They have to go now. Blink Crush gonna be coming in. Three man Crush, but a Tombstone on the high ground is gonna give them some real difficulty. Nice combo from the Tiny, doing a lot of damage, but he just evaporates so quickly. They'll mech, they'll Soul Rip, and they'll sustain. They lose the Tombstone, but Wings are winning the fight. Innocence will go down in the back line. Beyond gets a Walrus Punch to kill off the Bane, and now QD is in some real trouble again. This guy can't do anything but die and die and die. It's so unfortunate, but it's the way of Avenge. 3-5-4 his KDA. Roche, they're about to slay. Cleaning it up here, Aegis will be reclaimed by Wings Gaming, and they'll give it to the Viper, since obviously one of their number already has power over life and death. Oh man, this is getting out of control very quickly versus Skadaria. I feel like they needed to play a bit more of a rat game. Yeah, they feel more confident in their ability to take fights once they have these blinks, but like you saw how stretched they were. They rushed in, getting the Slaughter Dart blink crushed, and they weren't really able to do much with it. Like, you hit three heroes, you deal a Radiant's nuke of 225 physical damage to three heroes, but you don't get to do anything more with it. And I feel like either patience or just avoiding the enemy. Oh, QD! This is not... Oh, he gets Nightmared at least. He might be okay here. Just running for his life, now turning around onto Shadow, who is going to be having to reincarnate very early in this engagement. The Undying actually bought back here. He got swapped under tower, killed off. Now it's going to be QD that gets focused down. Lived a lot longer than I expected, but still the first to die again. Bane will be going down on the northern front. We'll watch Rong taking some major hits and will be falling next to that Wraith Fire Blast. Yeah, Bane, that's an interesting position. Looks like he tried to kite into the trees there. Anyways, he goes down the tower as well, and Wings are just on a tear right now. 18-12. They did have to buy back on the Undying, but he's got gold to spare with the amount of assists he's racked up. 4-3-11. Now they will have the mechanism for their high ground push, and that's going to be something that DK have to do anything to avoid. I really feel like if this Tiny had just been ratting out by one of the lanes, or if they had just picked up more mobile heroes and more farm intensive heroes, that maybe they could have just dragged this game out through split push. But the Skadaria lineup still kind of forces confrontations, and Wings just have the better hand right now. I mean, the net worth of the Venge suddenly still at 5,200. Last we looked at her, she was only 600 below that. And she may be completing her Yasha here, but the Viper already has his Yasha on top of his mechanism and everything else. It's just Wings have the upper hand in so many ways right now. And I'm not seeing an easy way back into it. I mean, maybe Boubacar can kind of split push with Y-Chen, and they can try it for something. Oh, a smoke is also a great way to make things happen. It looks like they're going to be smoking in 4 versus 4. And unless they get a very quick pick, it's not going to be totally favorable. XXS losing the smoke here. Can he get the proper blink? No, they missed their target. Y-Chen blinks forward. He gets the tombstone down, but they will kill him off pretty quickly here. Actually, the Soul Sumption was minimum damage. And that means he's going to survive for as long as needed to turn this fight around. They lose the Bane, they lose the Visage, they can't even kill the damn Undying. Oh my. They don't have a hope at this point if they can't execute on that level. I mean, they didn't even kill the Tombstone or the zombie himself. And it really, it comes down to the Soul Subject cast. He cast it when he had zero souls assumed. It doesn't accumulate while it's in projectile. So when you fire it at zero, just because the guy loses 80% of his health through the next second, it doesn't build itself while it's in the air. It's still going to do that like pinprick of damage. It's actually like, what? Base damage is 20. So 20 magical damage coming out from Rong to help burst down that Undying. Just no. Looks like QD in some trouble again, all by himself with no tower to help him. He'll go for a swap play. It will get him some distance, but in the end, he's just cornered. Ice Shards will be his demise, and that is Avenge dying for the 7th time. 3-7-5 on the bench. We'll look up top. Maybe they have a chance here since 2 were committed bottom. Beyond has no TP. Innocence has no mana. Maybe they could make it, but no, they're afraid.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Birds. Alright, so things are not looking good, obviously, for DK Skadaria. Tier 1 and Tier 2 up top have fallen, and they're just having to kind of rally for what might be their final hour.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
I mean, they're kind of posturing to contest, tower is under attack. But they certainly have their hesitation. All right, so the Tiny is going to be going for a drum, going to be good against the Tombstone and good for a hero that relies so heavily on attack speed. Pretty much just wants to activate that every fight without hesitation. We're going to see a four-man smoke go through here. Roshan's not going to be spawning for another 4 minutes, and Aegis just got reclaimed. So Wings actually did lose a little bit in the fact that 5 minutes have passed, but they're doing so well right now, objective-wise, and now going in. They see the starter under the ward. Quick punch, quick kill. And with that, if Wings can take 4v5s, you better believe they're going to be fine to go in 5v4 under any tower. And immediately, yeah, you need to be TPing top. You need to be pushing out the side lanes as hard as possible, because you know that they're just going to waltz right down bottom lane and take everything. Aegis or not, I feel like Wings are very confident here. Alright, it's going to be the Radiance build, which is not bad. Shadow picking up Radiance here is pretty solid. So, it is Blade Mail, Radiance, and then I hope the Axe. I actually think it's so strong after I thought about it further. We're actually going to see YChan in a little bit of trouble, but he'll be okay. But yeah, I actually think the Aghanim Scepter, while kind of silly, Radiance and for a lot of lineups, pretty irrelevant, for this lineup, it's actually pretty sweet. QD, Shadow Amulet it up, under Ascension Ward, no less. But he'll try to see if he can kind of catch somebody off guard here. Ice, walking right by. No Meld Strike coming in from the Venge. In fact, she's being swarmed right now, and the birds are the magnet. They're going to break down some trees and try to find their opening. He's just got to run for the hills. Yeah, birds have fallen. Everybody's going to go for him. No trees to hide under. And I guess they feel like that's bait. So they're just going to keep him backing off.
Mine.
Necronomicon on Lina. They really want to end this game by 35 minutes, so this is the best way to do it, is just build up a mass of Necro Books. The enemy doesn't have great AoE clear, no counter push, like I said, so these are just going to be free siege damage on the tier 3s. But we're going to see maybe a jump here. Shadow does have Reincarnate level 2, but going to be coming back into a terrible position as they've still have two bird stuns to throw at him. He will pop the Blade Mill. They will wait that out, get the crush, and get the kill. Very nice kill to pick up there. Venge grabs herself 450 more gold, and we'll be building up towards that Shadow Amulet pretty quickly. I almost wouldn't hate a Glimmer Cape, to be honest with you guys. I know it's a support item over like the Shadowblade core, but man, she needs some way to survive. She has 1200 HP. She has no mechanism on her team. Anytime she gets hit by a stun, I feel like that she's inches from death. Of course, the Nightmare save last time was pretty strong, but that's not always going to be there. Tiny has his blink, walks into a sigil, but he's smoked up. Oh, Courier will actually get sniped in the beginning of this exchange, it looks like. But they're going to focus on the stuns. They're going to focus on the kills. Beyond gets the blink away. They waste their Avalanche Toss and Crush. And while the Courier does die, we're going to see Radiant fall very shortly thereafter. Bobakai and QD have some trouble finding their focus. They go for the Fiend's Grip. They still don't kill the Tusk. And now they're losing heroes. They did kill the Undying. Ron gets Laguna. He goes down. And XXS is now on the run. Sprint has expired, though. His blink put on CD. It does get to the trees. No, one more poison attack, and he's still going to be unable to blink. XXS ticking it out, timing it out, going for the blink TP now, and he should be okay. So all in all, it was an okay fight for DK Scuderia. Not great, but 2-for-1, a lot better than most of the exchanges we've seen this game. And the Courier snipe means no Radiance recipe for Shadow until it goes back to base. A little bit annoying for him, since they could just go for Roche and go for the end of the game. Well, I would normally advocate for Desolator for a split push. Shadowblade might be the tool he needs to be mobile here. Drums, look at his movement speed here. 490 MS in the Shadowblade. Pops his stun. Shadow goes down without reincarnating, but Venge, it just flops over. Everybody will flop. She is so dead. Viper, on the other hand, will be hit up by four heroes, so you better believe he won't last long either. And Familiars are trying to catch this Lina, but she is getting the Glimmer away for now, and the Blind Bird Stun will not saw him. Snowball times two and a combo from the Innocents will be killing off the Slardar, but in turn, the Lina will be taking a big hit, and they'll focus on the Tombstone while putting the nukes into Ice Ice. So it looks like Undying is down as well. Glimmer or not, he should fall if they pursue him, but no, they kind of get distracted by the Tusk. There it is, the death of the Undying. Leon hiding in the trees here, but he'll be okay. And a great exchange, by all means. I mean, their deficit is going to be negated significantly just by the Gold Swing here. Getting that, it doesn't show all the kills. Obviously, the Viper, the Wraith King, and the Venge all died prior to this. But that's still, in total, a 4-for-3. And so you're seeing much more than just a 1,000 Gold Swing. And you're seeing it here on the graph. Pretty solid in terms of comeback potential. They need more fights like that. Just chaotic. When Wings are on point, they're able to focus their targets down, and they don't have to ask themselves whether or not they need to engage or disengage. Then Wings just clearly barrel over their opponents. But as fights get more complex, as the engagements get more hot and heavy, I feel like Wings might not have such a clear advantage, especially when they lose a hero like Viper that early in the engagement. Viper, who, by the way, has a Mantis staff. Obviously, things like the Radiance Recipe that are still not coming out on the Courier just yet is a big factor to why that fight wasn't better, because Shadow obviously would have participated a lot more with more right-click damage and more, obviously, the Aura. Oh, and the mischance. I haven't even thought about that coming into play, but there's a lot of right-clickers here for DK Skidaria, so Radiant's mischance is pretty awesome. We're going to see Roche traded out for the Tier 2 top. Tiny chunks that one down pretty quickly here with the Aghanim Scepter effect. Blink Ags, Drums. Tiny's in a decent way, but that doesn't mean that they're going to be able to take these racks so easily. Aegis will go, and immediately the TPs go back. They glyph it, and they're ready to fight. If Wai Chen stays, Wai Chen dies, but he uses the Blink. Get one more free hit in before heading home. So, all in all, it is a... I would say it's still an okay trade for Wings, because now you don't really have anybody pushing in your top lane. You have this Aegis, which is your key to ending the game before the Tiny Rat becomes a real problem. When Tiny gets, like, BOTs and Moonshard and stuff like that, then AC, of course, you're going to be really worried about your towers getting chunked down and you having to balance between offense and defense. But at this stage in the game, just 28 minutes in, Wings could very well just end the game with this Aegis, and that's why I think it's such a key objective they can lose the Tier 2 top. Ward on ward action, Glimmer versus Smoke. You know, it looks like nobody's going to find the opening
Dire's
here.
Bottom tower is under attack.
Sorry, getting a drink. So we've got ourselves the smoke going, roaming through the Radiant Jungle, but nothing really happening here. Just Shadow showing himself, and they have the Fiend, I think. Where is that Bane? No, across the map. So no. I mean, they're probably here, you don't want going anyways. You see him, you don't see him, doesn't matter. They're just going to TP away. So, Wings dominate the Radiant Jungle, but they have to worry about the Dire. Even if it's not the Tiny pushing, it's still this creep wave at the top of the steps. You're not going to be able to break the base while this is going on. You have to start keeping heroes back. And these heroes don't have BOTs, so they're choosing defense, which means that they're forced into at least 60 seconds of passivity. So I think the play is you push out the creep wave to about here. Maybe you bring it all the way to the northwest here. Either way, you push it out. One more creep wave beyond this one, and then you go for the smoke play, and you just go for the full offensive. Courier for the Venge, what does she want next? She's got her... probably Manta finished through Ultimate Orb, and we'll see it, yeah. So, she has her Shadow Blade, she'll want her Manta style, that'll give her a little bit of tankiness, and maybe the ability to dodge a couple of key projectiles. The Viper Strike, the Wraith Fire Blast, technically the Laguna Blade can all be dodged. Through the appropriate timing of Manta style. Oh, but here's that smoke play I was talking about. Now the creep wave has pushed out. The birds are actually pushing out up top, but that Observer Ward, again, really hurting Bobakaw, and now he loses the gem. So they're going to be completely blind on the map. There is one ward in play. An interesting one at that. But yeah, so the birds will keep pushing while the Bane is dead, but most likely we're going to see Wings just go all in on the Rax here. They've got 2 minutes left on the Aegis. They don't have to worry about them getting backdoored up top, so they will just kind of look to end this here, at least with one lane down by the time this Aegis expires. And that's going to be DK's Skidarius call to action. Can they actually hold this? We're going to see XXS just see the Wraithfire Blast at long range. Still Tiny, he's just barreling down the top lane. He's just trying to kill off the creep wave, trying to get to that tier 3 top, trying to trade evenly for the Rax. And with the birds, double stun? No! The Soul Rift is going to keep the tombstone alive, and they just fed both birds. XXS going to be stunned up here. They're just throwing things away. They'll resummon some birds, going to lose one. And up top, we're actually going to be seeing the Y-Chen hit on the tier 3s. They might be able to trade these Rax evenly now, as Wings have fully committed themselves. A lot of them don't have TPs. None of them have TPs. Only Innocence has a TP, and he can't stop the Venge Tiny from killing off the top Rax. It's all or nothing now. It's going to be a full-on base race. Wings are going for the top lane of Rax, so we're not looking at Thrones yet. One lane of Rax in mid is gone for the Radiant. One lane top for the Dire, but now Rong going to be comboed up on. Doesn't really have much left for this world. We'll sell something beyond instead of the Blade Mail, and he will force the Reincarnate nevertheless. Y-Chen buys himself a BKB after killing those Rax and does pop it to be the big man walking. A swap back onto Ice Ice means he'll be going down to the Crush, and they have just traded even on Barracks. That's what I've been looking for all game long. The split push plays to break down the five man of Wings. That's all they needed to do. And now they're going to pop the Aegis as well. I think that was going to expire shortly, but now it's gone with that second life as well. And that is going to be DK Skidarius swinging back hard. They do lose HP on the tier 3, 626. But you see the line drawn on the map, they're just like, welp, next lane. Oh my gosh. So as far as recapping who had TPs and that, I know Innocence definitely did. I believe the Wraith King did, yeah, we see it now. But the Viper didn't, the Undying didn't, and the Tusk didn't. So three heroes out of the five did not have TP scrolls, and Shadow was the one that kind of had to be on the front line in mid. So he didn't really have the luxury of going back. Maybe he should have given his TP to an ally so they could have dressed the Tiny, because just giving the Tiny free time to go on their barracks, and we see that DK actually got the better trade structurally. The Ranger Axe did not fall in mid. The tier 3 didn't fall up top. It's the entire lane that got wiped out on Wing's side. So yeah, this is getting very dicey very quickly. You don't want to deal with a Tiny that can split push to this extent. Now he's got a BKB, which the Viper should be able to handle pretty well with his ultimate, especially if he goes for Ags next. Walrus Punch and Viper Strike both can be used to kite the Tiny, assuming you don't get craggied. And, of course they have a 4 staff too. But, right now, DK Skidarius are taking an advantage in this game where they were so far behind before. I mean, it was 8,000 plus net worth at their deficit, same with experience, here just 10 minutes ago. And now look at him. Just able to win it out through just extended range on the side lanes. Now, I do want to talk about a nice little synergy that really hasn't come up yet, but the Tiny bonus damage from Grow is base damage. So what you have here is 150 increased damage to your base, which is the reason that double damage runes are so strong on Tiny, because it also doubles your base damage. But Ventral Spirit is another enhancer of this. She goes 36% increase in base damage. And so, you know why Tiny Wisp always has a Vlads on the Wisp? It's because of that base damage increase. And the Vengeful Spirit is twice as effective as a Vladimir's Offering. So, it is going to be... Because the Venge was there, she was actually able to make the Tiny kill things off 36% faster. It's really solid. Normally, you wouldn't see both the carry and the mid get some free FaceTime with the enemy barracks, though. That is something that Wings just made a mistake on. Oh, Link Crush gonna be wasted here. Smoke. Not gonna be fooling anybody, but DK Skidarius are on the hunt. They're moving. They're grooving. They're looking really good. What have we here? Now, you just have to... You can't let your side lanes even close to your side of the map. Now, they have to push out all three lanes at once. And I'm not sure the easiest way to do that. Of course, Lina can go for some creep clear. The radiance helps from shadow, but end of the day, if you have any creep wave past the river, as we saw, the tiny is happy to just go to town and just head over to the dire base as quickly as possible with all his creeps. The Necronomicon speeds their ability to break the base down, but obviously it wasn't fast enough. You don't base race the mountain. This guy's just too fast, too furious with the Aghanim Scepter upgrade. I guess for some of the newer viewers, I should just note why Tiny is so good at breaking down the base. Not only does he have, right now, 340 attack damage, but he also has this Aghanim Scepter, which allows him to deal bonus damage to buildings. He actually gets 175% damage to structures. So, he's able to just siege away at them, and it's very convincing in terms of his ability to kill off the enemy barracks. And oh, QD might just find himself a 3v1 opportunity here. Yeah, QD is on the run. I guess they don't want to take this fight, but they actually could have isolated Shadow, killed him off quick. Problem with that mentality is, of course, Reincarnate is now level 3, and if you're not certain you can kill him off the second time, it's probably not worth killing him off the first time. Yeah, BKB up for the Ventral Spirit. AC up for the Tiny next. And yeah, Wings, they have to find an answer. They have to find a way to break down the Radiant structures quickly. Because in the end, kills mean nothing. Throne means everything. The Radiant of the Dire Ancient is all that really matters. And right now, DK Scudera are in a better position to claim the oppositions. Tiny going to be finishing up that AC very soon, it looks like, because he's sending, already over to the Secret Shop. He could be going for Moonshard. It's definitely possible. I think the negative armor, bonus armor might be better, but we'll see. Moonshard? No. Whoa. Okay, that's, Solar Crest for the Visage, and AC for the Tiny. Birds, again, creating space in their own special way. But yeah, Wings are in an awkward spot. The Rosh has just respawned. They're less confident in the pit now. And actually, we're going to see here, top lane, the Crush comes down onto Beyond, and he does get four staff, but still will be going down. Now Innocence is real trouble, gets swapped back. That's going to be the death of Lagoonig without even Lagooning. Because the cooldown's the death timer, you might as well just Laguna, but no, that's actually Rosh going to DK. And without that, I have to think that the tables have turned drastically. Where I thought that, like, the game is now 60-40, with the Rax falling up top, favoring DK Scuderia, now it's like 80-20 because of this Roshan. Aegis and Cheese going to Scuderia, and honestly, Wings were completely dependent on Aegis and Cheese for every confrontation. I mean, if you look at actually how the fights played out, the Aegis hadn't really factored that much because the Viper dies twice anyways. Oh, yeah, there's a Radiance there, bro. Gonna be seeing the Fiend's Grip canceled out pretty early on, but QD has at least one swap to send, and he's gonna send it onto Shadow here, so gonna be able to nuke him down very quickly. Negative armor, really hurting. Look, negative 16 armor. We're gonna see Wraith King, despite the Blade Mail, just being chunked down by two behaved heroes, and that's gonna be forcing a buyback. His third life coming out here, but it's gonna be DK that just start running down the Dire. Shadow gonna be falling very quickly. Viper, actually, the target of choice, and wow, does he go down quick. That's only forcing the Aegis on Tiny. Viper, moving away at 250 HP, can't get back into this fight. Bobakas stunned up, a great Lyser, great times three. And a Nightmare coming out on the Tiny here, so the disables are going in an interesting fashion. And Wrong is actually gonna be singled out by the Wraith King. Buyback coming in from the Undying, living up to his reputation, but Innocence will be finished off by the big tree. Clubbed down once more. So enough buybacks and enough kills are going to be forcing DK back. They go for the full offensive, and they can't really hold that position on the high ground after all those buybacks. Especially now that we see Wraith King is about to reincarnate again. Just overall fight recap, pretty important here. Wings still lose there. They hold their ground, they get the Aegis, but they do lose. Killing three heroes, buying back two, losing four in total. Or five if you count the reincarnate. So while Wraith King did get himself up to level 20 here, his buyback gold penalty made his gold kills and assists pretty inconsequential, and he ended up losing the most of anybody while Tiny continues to move forward. So all in all, DK Scuderia do get sent packing, but they are able to profit from it even more than their opposition and continue to move the graphs in their direction. Now, Cheese, I didn't see what became of it. I didn't even see who picked it up, but it has been consumed in that last exchange. MKP up for the Viper. Obviously strong against the Solar Crest, since Viper is not going to be going for BKB here. But that's about it. At this point, Tiny, AC complete. What is he looking for next? Well, he doesn't have a TP right now, so probably BOTs. BOTs, then go for the Moon Shard. And then you're really in business. Personally, I wouldn't mind having a Manta over the BKB, but obviously Weichen has already bought the BKB and it's still in 9 seconds, so or 8 seconds, so it's not something he's going to drop anytime soon. DD again. I feel like they just need to find some amazing way into a fight. Bottling a double damage rune is one way. Lina Aghanim's is another. They just need to bring so much more to the next engagement than they have in the past two. Because right now, their net worth is being trumped. And well, this Venge, who died 7 times in like 25 minutes, is now second in net worth. He's doing more than the Viper in every fight. And has the items she needs to survive the engagement. Manta Diffusal. Along with the Shadowblade BKB, so you can kite people really well. Just spam out. You might as well, since at this stage in the game, since the next fight could very well determine who wins the game, you might as well just use like 4 defusal charges in a fight. It's no cooldown. Just keep it on the Wraith King constantly, and all he can do is radiate. So that's my opinion at least, but we'll see. Weichen gonna be moving forward with XXS, trying to break the smoke, trying to find their opening, and smoke on smoke, BKB, jump on XXS, he's not getting the crush off he wants, but Weichen is gonna be able to BKB off most of Innocent's damage. He still gets the Laguna out, thanks to the Aghanim Scepter, but they're gonna be able to get the Fiend's Grip here on the Viper. The Shadow's just trying to use his health as actively as possible, but it is gonna be the death of the Viper to the north, and Weichen at a third HP, has to watch himself here, gonna be dropping very low very quickly, gets stunned up, and will be killed off beyond ticking down to the urn charge, and the rest will fall. DK actually losing 4-2, and even some birds looks to be going down, yep. So, they do end up buying back, looks like the Viper bought back, but he's going right down mid lane. You see exactly where his intentions are. The range racks fell of their own volition, but we're going to be seeing them, maybe goes just for Throne. Like, I was going to say bottom lane, but Throne actually seems really good right now. Of course, you have to be aware of the buybacks, and we're going to see Tiny buyback in a flourish here. Look for some kills on his second coming. But for now, the Viper just going to be another toxining down this tier 3 bottom with the Manta style. And it's actually going to force a glyph, a very bad glyph, if I must say. But yeah, they're going to go ahead and keep this tier 3 alive. And might make the difference. AC on the Wraith King will finally counter out the one that Titania has been holding onto for some time, but I mean, that's been sorely needed. You saw how much negative armor was against him. I think he had about negative 16 armor in the last fight, thanks to all the debuffs put against him. I gotta say, Venge is transitioning. She's her 3.3 agi gain is turning her into a real core hero. I mean, you see, what, 330 damage on her per hit. She attacks very quickly right now. And then she is going to be building up herself the Helm of the Dominator going into like kind of like that Butterfly Satanic late game. These do stack, by the way, guys. Diffusal and the lifesteal. No problems there. We do see Vlad's picked up by Rong. Haven't really checked in with him. He got the Solar Crest, the Ags, as we expected, but the Vlad's is that next pickup. And if he's ever with the Tiny, that's a really big deal. And they're just looking for their next opening. This tier 2, you can't really jump in for the tier 3 in the racks without Dyer's at least claiming this small tower in the interim. So, toppling that one down quickly, it's the stepping stone to a broken base. Already, yeah, it probably needs to just backdoor bottom. That's pretty essential, actually. It only has 200 HP. Tiny can easily wreck that through backdoor protection. And I think they should, because you want to be able to get to the bottom racks as well. Oh, seriously? Is that... I mean, to be fair, when do you actually look at that part of your base? Like, just looking around over here randomly, you're not really doing that as a Dota player. Just kind of moving around on the map. You're really focused on really where your enemy can be more than anything else. But we're going to see Shadow Blink again. Going to be crushed. He's going to be focused down, but he will be coming back for a second life. And this sets up a possible fight for Wings as they drop the Tombstone down. As they're doing everything they can, the Laguna Blade going to hit on Y Chen. The Fiend's Grip only goes on Illusion, but they are going to Walrus Punch down the Bane anyways. Viper dropping very low in this exchange. Shadow about to lose his second life, and he has the dieback. This is two diebacks, three diebacks. That might be the game. As they lose everything here, they have killed the Tiny, but if Tiny just buybacks, as we see, he'll just jump into the front line and they will go for the throne. There are no buybacks on the Viper, the Undying, or the Wraith King, and they know it. Undying is actually cooling down, but he doesn't have the gold. So that leaves that question in the equation, but all the same, they know that only at most three heroes are defending the Ancient at this point, and they're not even going to bother with the racks. They're just going to go for the throne. Tier 4s, now their target. And they can just focus this down. Tiny coming in. Very fast movement speed. Has the blink as well. So he's going to be here. And that's the GG. Wings will, in the end, lose out the first game of this best of three series. Just Tiny things. The Mountain Giant wins out with that one base race play up top. And you even saw at the last second there on the minimap that the Undying was drawing in the top left corner of the map. Pretty much saying the exact same thing I was. They needed the creep wave pushed out further. One more creep wave so the Tiny couldn't get there quickly enough. But in the end, Wings didn't push fast enough. Tiny outpaced them. And DK take victory here in game one of this best of three series. Wow, what a game. A significant turnaround, quite a comeback. And showing that the rat is still alive. The Venge pick, I'll still flame it. I still think it didn't do much at all. But, you know, the Vengeance Aura did apply. And the one key play he was a part of, and otherwise he did his part. 47-minute game in the books here for game one of this best of three series. We're going to be going into the second game here in just a few minutes, guys. We've got some great games of Dota 2 here in Starladder iLeague China coming up, so you won't want to miss it. Once again, I'm myself, M. Blaze. You can follow me on Twitter, @BlazeCasting, if you enjoyed the commentary, and I'll be bringing in a co-caster for game number two. See you then.